say hallelujah. Can you say yee-haw? Oh, that was Friday night, wasn't it? That was Friday night's gig. Now we're on to a new thing. How about giving praises unto the Lord? Come taste and see that the Lord is good today, huh? In our leadership class today, we learned about tasting and seeing that the Lord is good so that our eyes are opened up to see the things that we can't even see. Because when our eyes are opened up, when we've been in His presence, man, the whole world opens up to us, and it's called faith. Amen? It's called building our faith. So today, in the name of Jesus, I pray as your hands go lifted up, you have the faith to understand that as you lift up your arms unto Him, not worrying about who's looking around, who's listening to you, but our Father receiving everything He wants to give to you, coming right back to you because you've praised and honored Him. Amen? We glorify you, Father, in this place. We thank you, God. And we tasted and saw that the Lord, you are good in our lives. In Jesus' name, come Holy Spirit. Let all who call on the name of the Lord receive. Amen. If you're a visitor in the house, Miss Rowan has a gift for you. Come on up, Miss Rowan. She is one serving in all these areas. Can you grab some of these packages? Raise your hand if today's your first day ever visiting. Yes. Right here in the back, give him a big hand. First time visiting our Sunday morning church right there. Glad to see you and your lovely boys. Amen. All right, you guys ready? Ready to worship? All right, do it again. Are you ready?
And God of Jacob, great I am. King of angels, Son of man. Voice of many waters, song of heaven's throne. Louder than the thunder, make your glory known.
Thank you.
'cause your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a
shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from
about something for real quick. I was reading in Luke about when Jesus sent the disciples out two by two into all of the towns that he was going to be speaking in. And the word that he said to the disciples, let me find them. Now off you go. I am sending you out even though you feel as vulnerable as lambs going into a pack of wolves. You won't need to take anything with you. Trust in God alone, and don't get distracted from my purpose by anyone you meet along the way. Because so many times, the enemy tries to come in, and right when we're about to overcome, he tries to come in, and he tries to pull us back. We're right at the peak of that mountain, and he knows that we are about to overcome all of those battles that we just went through, but he tries to pull us back. But God says that even though you feel as vulnerable as a lamb in a pack of wolves, I am with you. Amen. He is with you.
Yes.
And that is the simple fact about it. When you're afraid, when you're sad, when you feel alone, he's with you. And sometimes those simple words of him being with you are the hardest to listen to because it seems so simple. But it's the most powerful thing. And so the disciples go out, and they're afraid, but they are believing that God is with them. And they come back, and they talk about all the amazing things they experienced because God told them, he said, go heal the sick. Go cast the demons out because I'm with you.
Amen.
And Jesus replied, while you were ministering, I watched Satan topple until he fell suddenly from heaven like lightning to the ground. Now you understand that I have imparted to you my authority to trample over his kingdom. You will trample upon every demon before you and overcome every power Satan possesses. Absolutely nothing will harm you as you walk in my authority. When you speak the name of Jesus, Satan trembles. When you speak the name of Jesus, depression flees. The demon of depression, the demon of anxiety, the demon of fear, the bondage that you hold is shaken off because you spoke the name of Jesus.
'Cause your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire.
Death could not hold you. The veil torn before.
Morning, everyone. I'm Pastor Charlotte, and I'm here bearing gifts. The Bible says that Jesus knew where he had come from and where he was going to, and so he girded himself about with a towel and became a servant, washing the disciples' feet. And part of that is our ministry today with each other. The Bible says for us to be a body, and a body fits together. So look at your neighbor and say, I fit, I belong, I'm recovering. In Jesus' name. The Bible was speaking to me this morning in devotions as I was reading through the book of Ruth. And as you know, Ruth's mom-in-law was named Naomi. But she didn't like that name because the Lord had hit her with a hard and a bitter blow. How many of you guys have ever been hit with a hard and bitter blow? Well, there's healing in the blood of Jesus today for you. There's recovery in the name of Jesus for you. It's hard to think back on those moments whenever you felt like God abandoned you, whenever you felt like God forsook you, whenever you were surprised with a trauma. I want to share a little bit about a trauma that Mark and I experienced, and I want to share the glory of going through that struggle and embracing it as a gift from God. Do you know what today is? The date? May 15th. This is the day that an angel from God was born and ministered into Mark and I's life. When our little boy Eric was born in 1981, we had dreams and hopes for him. He was a little red-headed, curly-headed little boy, and at 21 months of age, he fell into the creek behind our house and was drowned. Tragically, he did not survive. He went home to be with the Lord, but our overcoming victory testimony is that Laureen Sonneborn had a visitation in her home from the Lord Jesus Christ, and she said, Jesus said for me to pay to bury your little boy. Now, I don't know about you, but in my heart, that was a surprise. It was also bittersweet. And I, like Naomi, could have said, I have been dealt a hard and bitter blow. But Jesus knew ahead of time that Laureen was going to be born on May 15th, and Laureen was going to have a visitation from Jesus Christ. So I want you to understand and grasp the concept. If you've been hit with a hard and bitter blow, you know who knows? Daddy God. Daddy God knows. And Daddy God sees, and Daddy God will deliver. So I want you to say these two things. From Moab.
From Moab.
To Bethlehem.
To Bethlehem.
Naomi went from Moab, her place of removal from her body of believers, the Israelites. She went down to Moab in a time of famine. But when she came back to Bethlehem, she came to the land of Judah. How many of you know what Judah means? Praise. So raise your hands up. Say, Daddy God, I've been dealt a hard and bitter blow. But you, Daddy God, see me, know me, and will deliver me. So I eat in Bethlehem bread. Bethlehem, you can put your hands down. Bethlehem means the house of bread, and bread is necessary for us to eat. How many of you know what this is called? A nickname. Bread or dough. It's hard green cash. And I want you, as a testimony of your victory from a hard, bitter blow, to bring your cold, hard, green cash and sow it as a testimony in this season that Daddy God, even though I believe it was you that gave me that hard, bitter blow, I'm going to make a black eye in the face of Satan and say, no, I'm not going to be angry with my daddy anymore. I'm not going to be upset against Jesus. I'm not going to hold back from a relationship with the Holy Spirit. I'm going to give my everything. Anyone in here who does not have a seed to sow today, I would like to give you some cold, hard cash to sow into the kingdom of God. And before you come forward, I want to give a gift to my friend Samantha. She's a worshiper, and she worships God with all of her heart, soul, mind, and strength. And as a testimony of my belief in her, I wanted to give her a set of earrings that my niece created. And all of the worship team got to wear their gifts. The girls got to wear their worship gift on Friday night at the Hoedown. And as you come, I'm going to be standing down here with some bread. Belveda, blueberry flavor. And as you sow your cold, hard gift of cash, I want you to understand that Jesus is your bread of life, and he wants you to be ministered to today. Thank you, Father. Say, Daddy God, I'm a believer, not a doubter. I have faith in you. You have faith in me. We're going to get it done. Amen.
Prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord.
To, but if they want to go back, that's up to them. How many of you had a great weekend so far? It's kind of one that's going down into the books. We're midway through a great weekend, so we're not done yet, right? We got some more stuff going on today. But today is a special time for a lot of us. I know it is for me and mine. How many of you know the Bible says to raise up a child in the way they should go, and when they get old, they will not depart from it? And how many know that God places people in your life that just, the whole intent and purpose of that plant is to help grow you into what He has called you to be. When you don't receive that, that was not for you at the time. But those that do receive, it was for you. We got born again. I got saved in 1991. But Susie got saved, you know, a little while before me. So therefore, you know, kids loading up on Sunday mornings, going to Sunday school, and I'd be going golfing. That's the way it was. I worked six days a week. Can I have one day? That was, you know, my argument. And she would, you know, let in on me, and Sunday morning roll around again. She's getting the kids up ready for Sunday school, and I'm putting my shorts and my shoes on and my little socks, and I'm carrying my clubs. Sure you don't want to go to Sunday school and church today? Nope, I'm good. How many of you know that God had a plan? See, I was hearing about God on the golf course. Wasn't paying a whole lot of attention to it. But when my wife quit nagging me about going to church, listen, that made me not want to go that much more. But when she quit nagging me, it got to where Sunday morning, I think I'll go to church with you today. I think, you know, we'll go as a family today. And lo and behold, you know, I gave my life to the Lord and never been the same since. But thank God for guys like this right here. John Schlitt. Everybody say, hey, John. John, you say hello, everybody. Yeah, we're riding around, and when I first got saved, I didn't have any Christian music. And I'm driving down the road. I mean, the Lord touched me because I'm listening to songs. If you get there before I do, don't give up on me. Country song. And I'd start crying about, you know, grandma and grandpa meeting years ago and putting a note on a tree. It started to get me, but then I started. Susie picked up a cassette tape. It wasn't digital or CDs then. It was a cassette tape. And we're driving down the road, and my kids are singing in the background. Notice it was in her car, not my truck. So we're driving somewhere, and I hear this music. I will call upon the Lord, and the kids call upon the who is worthy to be. And I'm thinking, what is this? And she starts telling me about Petra Praise. Listen, I said all that to say this. My kids were raised, little did John know, but millions of other kids, my friend, at this generation that you're looking at right now, that you have made a difference in their life. When God pulled you out of where you were and placed you on the solid rock, you have made a difference in kids, that generation of children's life. It don't matter about the one before that or the one after that, but that generation was your purpose. It was one of your purposes in this life. I know my kids were forever changed because of your music and the way you sang. I'm telling you straight up. At Newhart, and if you're in any of my music classes, guitar, drums, ukulele, our scripture is Psalms 144. And it said, blessed be the Lord my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle. I think that should be the musician's creed. Without any further ado, I want to introduce to you John Schlitt. He's a solo artist now, but he was the lead singer for Petra. So let's hear it up for John.
I have had quite the experience this weekend, folks. I mean, I was on stage last night with several people I've never been on stage before, and it was just a ridiculous blessing to see how God uses different people in so many different ways. Then I come to church, and I hear this ridiculous band. I mean, give me a break. Where did you guys come from? You almost have as many people in the band as you have in the people. But the band is stomping. The singers, oh, and then you have this cute little babe who's a better pastor than I am. I mean, what is she, 14? 18. Young lady. Man, is she on fire or what? And I'm saying, I don't even want to start singing because I'm sort of embarrassed because of the skill that I have to follow. But you know what? Jesus Christ is Lord. And he's given me a voice to praise him. And I'm going to do my best to praise him with the songs that he put on my heart before I even came here. Although we added one because I didn't realize what rockers you guys are. So, tell you what, let's do some singing. Is that cool? Come on, guys.
Blessed be your name.
Yes.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name, yeah. Blessed be the name. Blessed be your name when the tongue is as it should be and the will is as it should be. Blessed be your name, yes. Blessed be your name on a road marked with suffering. Those of pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Listen. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory. Blessed be your name, oh Lord.
bless the name of the Lord. Yes. Woo! Oh, guys, you know, this next song, as soon as this one runs out, is a song that I need help on. It's it pretty much, one section it goes, try this. Come on. Listen. I'm trading my sorrow. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. Yes. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. Here we go now. And we say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Oh, yeah. Man, listen. Well, I'm pushed but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, pressed down but not destroyed. Well, I am blessed beyond the curse, always promised to endure, that His joy is gonna be my strength. And though the sorrow may last through the night, the joy comes in the morning, yeah. I'm trading my sorrow. I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. All right. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. Okay, here we go. And we say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Amen. Not back in. Come on. What do we say? We say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Amen. Listen. But not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, pressed down but not destroyed. Well, I am blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, that His joy is gonna be my strength. And though the sorrow may last through the night, the joy comes in the morning, yeah. I'm trading my sorrow. I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord, yeah. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying it down for the joy of... Oh, here we go. You ready? We say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. One more time. We say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Oh, folks, this is fun. Thank you guys so much. You, when God opened the door for me to start doing solo stuff, my solo career, it was a far cry from what I did with Petra. Petra was pretty much you know, big shows, stadiums, that kind of stuff. We were able to, yeah, if you want to, please sit down. We got a chance to meet people afterwards, but really the personal touch had, as much as we wanted to, as much as we would try, it wasn't quite like it is now. I mean, come on. I walk into a church like this and I'm totally blown away. It encourages me as much as I hope I can encourage you. And with these songs I'm playing and with the praise and worship, I don't get to do these quite as much as I'd like to. Although Petra's had two, actually I've been part of three or four praise and worship albums, I don't get a chance to come to church and do them that often. And to see folks like you that are rockers but still like to praise the Lord is pretty impressive. I like that. Yeah. Well, this next song is actually a little slower, but it's a praise and worship song. And it was a hard song. I had to go back and relearn it because it's not one of mine. It was on one of our praise and worship albums. But it was like I could not remember the words. So if I blow the words today, you'll know that apparently I didn't work on it enough. Okay? Let's see what we can do.
You are holy, holy.
Praise God. This next song was actually one of the, I think, it's been done by many people, but apparently this, I think, was the biggest version of this song that is in Christian music now. And I praise God for it because I thought it was pretty good. I will tell you a story. The album's called We Need Jesus. And that single came out, and it actually did number one. And the record company was very surprised that it would. In fact, it was the last number one that Petra ever did. And I begged them to do this next record, do this next song, because it should be out there. So, no, everybody else has done it. I just don't think, no, we're just happy you got this one single, so that's good enough. That's how record companies sound to me. So this next song I'd like to do for you is something I'm sure you've heard, and I'd love for us all to sing it together. Are we cool? You certainly can sing, so that's no problem. Here we go. All right. Singers would know that song. I didn't mean to embarrass you. Jeez. Okay, everybody sit down, please. This next song is a song that was written by one of the guys in the band. I can't even tell you which one, but it's probably one of my favorite songs. The last time I said that, I messed up the words. In a great big church, while it was televised, got on the internet, so everybody gets to see me mess up one of my favorite songs. Here we go. But it's a song called Lovely Lord. I love the song. It's so sweet. And I praise God I'm able to sing it. Amen.
to be with you endlessly. Lord, how lovely you are to me. Lovely Lord, you are all to me. Lovely Lord, full of purity, worthy of honor and majesty. Lord, how lovely you are to me. You are bright as the sunrise and fairest of all. Unto you all the glory will be. You are God of creation and Lord of my life. I will worship you faithfully. Lord, how lovely you are to me. Thankful eternally. Lord, how lovely you are to me. Lovely Lord, you are all to me. Lovely Lord, full of purity, worthy of honor.
Very good. Very good to me, to my family. I was in a secular band before Petra. Actually, I've been in music my whole life, and I actually believed in God, guys, when I was a little guy, because my dad had like 3 heart attacks when he was 40, and I was scared to death that he was going to die every night. It's one of the, I think a lot of other sons go through that kind of stuff too. And so I pray to God every night for my family, but especially for my dad, that he'd wake up the next day. So God and I had a relationship. But as far as going to church, my mom was a Catholic, my dad was a Lutheran. And for a while, they tried to get me indoctrinated in both of them, and it was like a tug of war. If I didn't go to catechism on Saturday, I couldn't go to Sunday school on Sunday. It almost broke up our family. And finally, my parents go, you know, John, when you get old enough, you decide what church you want to go to. And I said, great, I just won't go. And so I didn't. All through high school, I prayed to God, didn't go to church. started a band, tried to be as good as I could, be a good guy, be a good guy, okay? I'm being a good guy and I pray to God. Well, went through college, got a degree, but meanwhile I discovered this band that is real good. And I actually joined them between my freshman and sophomore year in college, and almost flunked out of college my sophomore year. So I quit the band twice, and the second time I said, okay guys, I have to stay quit because I've got to graduate. I promised my parents I would, and I'm going to. And they said, well, you know, we're going to be big by the time you get out of college. I said, yeah, you probably will. Well, as I went through 26 different people in that three-year period, I took my last final exam, and I was on the stage with them that night. And by that time, the band was in bad shape. For the next 6 months, we struggled, and finally, we were going to break it up. And I looked at them, and I said, guys, the band we had that I started with is amazing. Let's get it all back together, and let's do it. Let's make it. So we did. And it was amazing. We put out our own record for $13,000. Guys, keep that number in mind because it comes back later. And we did a record instead of demo tapes. It was sort of, we thought it was going to be a demo record. And so we get this demo record. We start to send it out, and we sell them to try to pay the cost of the recording. And the record got to a couple of people in St. Louis. And two major stations in St. Louis and Kansas City started playing it and went number one instantly. And a singer or a musician's dream is to be in front of thousands of people every night. Well, almost instantly, we had three record companies coming to us. We had a new management that was nationwide. And we had a booking agent that was the biggest in the world. Bam, in about a month and a half period, we had the musician's dream. All of a sudden, we're playing, instead of bars, we're playing in stadiums, opening up, special guesting. All of a sudden, the single is going, and we have the musician's dream. And I keep harping on that because you would have thought that was the end of the story. I've made it. Well, the problem is, even if it's your dream, if you do it every night, it gets old. And once it gets so boring, yeah, being in front of 20,000 people is boring because it's over in an hour, hour and a half, and you go backstage, and what is there to do? You're hyped, you know, your adrenaline is still pumping, so you grab a beer, and then two beers, then three beers, because back then in the 70s, beer was water. Water wasn't cool yet. It didn't cost more than gasoline. So we had our bar back there, which was ridiculous, and we'd empty it, and even that got old. So what's next? Cocaine. That, you gotta understand that when I joined the band after graduating, I graduated as a civil engineer, and I figured I'd be in music for like 3 years, and then I'd be an engineer. I came from a little bitty town, had great parents, there was no reason for me to be stupid, but I was. I thought, I'll just be in music for a little while and then I'll do that. I'm not gonna get into drugs, I'm not gonna do any of that stuff. Well, when you're in the enemy's world and you don't have Jesus, you don't have Jesus. Did I pray to God? Yes, but I didn't know who Jesus was. Oh, totally different. I was in the enemy's world and he was using it to its full extent. Peer pressure, temptations of all kinds. And one night, we're celebrating the success of our album, and we end up in a Chicago dealer's house. And I didn't know that. He was good friends with the rest of the band. I didn't know what he did. And all of a sudden, he lays this big pile of coke on the table. And my road manager says, you know, John, you're in Bearings of Man. You're the lead singer. And you should be doing that because you're the singer. I mean, they're embarrassed. I said, and he says, cocaine is a perfect drug. It increases the blood vessels in your brain. It makes you smarter. Apparently, I needed that because I believed him. So I did a line. It was amazing. I was hooked. Next day, I did two lines. And And needless to say, as time went on, I needed more. It's all about the enemy. The enemy knows how to do it. And after 2 years or so, my whole days depended on how much coke I had in my pocket. I would drink like a fish, then I'd do a couple lines, I'd sober up. In other words, it was costing me $100 a day for artificial sobriety. The enemy gives me artificial sobriety, costs me everything and what God wants to give me for free. Because there was a certain high between beer or vodka, wine, whatever it was, and coke, where it was like this great feeling. Later on, when I finally got off of all this stuff, I realized it was sobriety. And what the enemy used to try to destroy me, God always wanted to give it to me for free. And that's the way it is always, folks. Every time the enemy tries to fly something in your face and go, this is so nice. Well, no, it's not nice. God wants you to have it anyway. Anyway, I got so bad, the band fired me. The band fired me in 1980. And you got to understand, as my brother would say, he was pretty much in love with himself. Yeah, I guess maybe I was, but I didn't know it until they fired me. And I said, you can't do that. I'm the lead singer. Jeez, I'm the star. And they did. For the next 6 months, I went on the binge that almost destroyed me. And what I mean is, I started another band and really was the only excuse. Went and got members all over that part of the country. It was a great band. We rehearsed and all, really, the only reason was so I could stay high, either coked up or drunk, 6 months in a row, almost 24 hours a day. Well, you can't do that and live. Yes, you can. If you've been doing it for the last 2.5 years, your body is sort of used to it. So I finally got to a point where the day after my anniversary, the 29th of August, I woke up on my couch and my one-year-old son's looking at me going, Dad, you know, he just had the look on his face. Well, why are you here, Dad? Why are you on the couch? And it was the first time my wife basically said, I've had it. I missed our anniversary party. I had been drinking like a fish thinking I would get coke to sober up and enjoy the party. Well, I couldn't find any and I passed out. And that was enough for my wife to say, okay, I've had it. So my one-year-old son is there on the couch. My five-year-old daughter is on the floor playing because I was in that room, so they chose to play in the living room. And as I'm looking at my son, a voice in the back of my head, it was clear as it could be, said, you know, you're worth more dead than alive. I said, you know what? That totally makes sense. That totally makes sense. So I get up, sit in the chair, watching my kids, and I decided right then I wasn't going to use a gun. I could get pills. And the pills, whatever I could find that would be as quick and painless as possible. And I'm sitting there trying to figure out how to do it. And my wife taps me on the shoulder. Oh, I forgot to tell you. This same 6 month period that I am totally getting blitzed, my wife becomes a Christian. Anybody who wants to stay blitzed, who has a wife who becomes a Christian, is not fun. I'm coming home feeling like, you know, dirt because I wanted to, you know, in a roundabout way. And my wife is coming home from a Bible study. She's all happy and joyous. It's like, I'm going, what world are you? I'm glad you asked. And she tried to tell me about Jesus. I said, no. He says, no, don't. I'm not going to be a Christian. Everybody knows being a Christian is no fun. You can't do anything. I'll be a Christian when I'm too old to have any fun. And she goes, okay, all right, I'll be back. And so I'm sitting in my chair, and all of a sudden, she taps me on the shoulder and says, John, remember, you promised you'd come and talk to my pastor tonight. I said, when? Last night when you were drunk. Well, how can you argue with that? And I said, okay, all right, okay. I'll come and talk to your pastor. I went with an attitude that nothing was going to change. I wanted her to remember that I tried. I'm serious. I wanted her to remember that I tried. I went to that pastor's house with an attitude, and I walked out with the Holy Spirit, and my life has changed. Woo! Yeah, give God, I'm serious. Give him. I am serious. If I hadn't walked in there and realized, and God was there waiting all guns hammering, and oh my gosh, to try to explain the whole thing would be too much time. But I walked out, and my life changed. When I gave my life to the Lord, when I said the sinner's prayer, when I finally could talk and said the sinner's prayer, it felt like a weight on my shoulders had been lifted up. I couldn't explain it for a while, but I'm telling you, that was the bondage that the enemy had been putting on me for so long. And all of a sudden, I'm free. I'm free. My friends, I've got, in my old band, I've got two guys who died. One from drug abuse, another from cancer. And my regret, especially for the one who died of drugs, was he went through three wives, and the last two were, well, actually all three were Christians. And the last one called me up and said, Dan really feels like he's not worth anything. And I said, well, put him on the phone. Tell him, of course he's worth something. God's got a plan. And he said, no, he won't talk to you. I regret not being able to talk to him because he really killed himself. And now, as I'm able to sing with you all, as I'm able to talk and spread, share my testimony, which everyone should do. I don't care if you were born again when you were two. You need to share your testimony because it was from God for you, and he's got a plan. And there's somebody out there that needs to hear it. Maybe not a two-year-old, but I mean, come on. But anyway, I walked out. The first thing I feel God ever said to me as I'm holding my daughter's hand, he says, you know those treasures you've been looking for? Because in Head East, I was always saying, well, you know, when we get a number one single, I'll be rich and everything will be fine. I can pay everybody back because everything came second. My family, my health, everything to the band. And I always had it just, well, I'm going to make it one of these days and I'll be able to pay everybody back. I'll be rich. I'll have the treasures and I'll be able to take care of everything. Well, God says, you know, the treasures you've been looking for so long, there they are. I've been taking care of them. Now it's time for you to do the same. I looked at her and I said, oh, thank you, Jesus. But I also felt, as time went on and I got with Petra, I realized that it wasn't just flesh and blood family. It was godly family. And as God opened up the door for me with Petra, I realized that everybody on that stage is my family. And in my case, because I'm so old, they're all kids. So I can look at all you kids. Are you just so cute? You're 65? Aren't you a cute little kid? And to be able to praise him, sing about him, use a very exciting music form called rock and roll to sing about truly the most exciting subject in the history of mankind, Jesus Christ. It was amazing. So as I walk there with my daughter, I walk out and I say, oh, incidentally, the enemy wasn't done. Because that band that I'd been doing for 6 months, it was starting to tour a little bit, playing in bars that were the lowest rent things I'd ever seen. Went out for months of weekends. Temptations were just ridiculous. Finally, I just said, I can't do this. I want to be the godly man that Christ wants me to be. I gave up music, every adult that was part of my life said, you can't do that, you can't do it. And finally, my wife said, here's how it is, it's music or me. It was the easiest thing I've ever done. It was like, okay, it's over, praise God. Became an engineer for the first time, tried to cut my hair and wear a three-piece suit and go in and talk to engineering firms saying, well, my resume says rock star for the last 8 years, but look, I've got short hair and a three-piece suit. Don't call us, we'll call you. So finally, someone trusted me in a tool and die factory. I was making $4.90 an hour, sweeping the floor in a tool and die factory, and working on dies in my spare time and drafting a little bit. I made less money a day than I used to throw away 6 months before for per diem. But I praise God for it because someone trusted me. Yeah. They opened the door to trust. They opened the door to where I could finally have a regular job and start forward. And God's timing, 6 months later, an increase, 6 months after, 6 months. For the next 5 years, it was like that. In fact, to a point where I thought, you know what? I remember sitting with my wife after I just finished my first home. I'm a do-it-yourselfer. Every house I've ever lived in, I've had to rebuild. So this first home I've rebuilt, and it's finally done. And we have, kids are going to Christian school, great church, great job, everyone's healthy and happy, and I have a house. And I'm thinking, wow, this must be it. And I'm telling you, I think the second time God ever spoke, said, John, this isn't it. This isn't it. And so I'm sitting there with my wife. It was a Sunday afternoon. I said, babe, I think God just told me this isn't it. And she said, what do you mean? I told her. She says, what do you think of that? I said, no idea. Remember, it's been 5 years since I sang. Music was totally out of my life. Nobody's going to be a rocker at 35. He's a fossil. Nobody can be a rocker at 30. So there's no possible way. So the idea of singing was not part of even a thought. So my heart's desire, I couldn't figure out what it was. About a month later, Bob Hartman calls me and said, John, would you consider being the singer for Petra? And I said, God, be kidding me. I said, you know what? Yeah, let's do it. He goes, well, don't you think you should pray about it? Yeah, okay. But remember, my wife said, music or me. So I'm thinking, oh, you know what? I looked at my wife, and apparently she knew what the conversation was about. And she's in her kitchen, jumping and leaping and praising God. I said, oh, well, maybe it's going to work. So long story short, part of Petra, traveled all over the world, was able to sing songs that I didn't write many. I didn't have to. I had some of the best writers in Christian music history, at least Christian rock history. And it was an honor to be able to do it. And now it gives me a chance to, even now after this history, I get to be with friends like you all. I get to be here. I get to talk about Jesus. We get to share. I get to see a ridiculous band that's out of nowhere. I get to be with friends, family that I've never met before. See, a church that puts the effort, the emphasis on kids, which you know you're going to grow because of that. Seriously, if you put emphasis on kids, you're a growing church. You better make some room because you're probably going to need it. And I love it. So I'm here saying thank you for allowing me to share. Thank you for allowing me to be interested, and thank you for using us. If you all didn't trust us and use us, we would have never done what we've been able to do. And it wasn't us. God would have never allowed us to do it. Because you don't know the strange five that were part of Petra. I mean, every day. The one thing we did before every show was we walked in. I mean, we might have been yelling, screaming at each other the whole time. We walked in, Lord, cleanse us. Forgive us. Help us to be what you want us to be. Let us be clean vessels as we walk on stage, and let your will be done. It was really easy because it wasn't us. We just stayed out of the way and let him do his thing. It's like today, you know, I try to stay out of the way. You got to understand, when I go to churches for the first time, I don't know what to expect. So my choices of songs can be sort of, I just never know, because I could do all the different kinds. I sort of regret a little bit of the selection here, because you guys could have used a lot more up stuff. So, but you know, the praise and worship is always to God, and it's so neat. But you know, speaking of stuff, I want to say thank you for, I want to say thank you to Jesus for the testimony he's allowed me to have, and for the fact that I'm here today sharing with you all. And to speak, Sharon, I'd like to do some songs for you. Is that okay? Because that's really what God has put in my heart to do. As they say, if you do what you love, you never work a day in your life. I haven't worked a day. Well, yes, I did. I worked for 5 years between Hades and Petra. But I'd like to do a song. This actually sort of debuted it last night. It's a title cut of my newest album. It's about the fact that when I wrote this album, the oldest new record I've ever had, because it came out 2.5 years ago. Thank you, COVID. So it hasn't had a chance to really be exposed. And this song's a title cut. And it's basically saying, you know what? We in the church can see the church as two things. We can have it as a refuge and be encouraged, refreshed. I think we're supposed to do that. But we can also realize that it's a boot camp where we get prepared and we go forward and we're the soldiers that God wants, the soldiers that he's going to use. So I have this feeling, you know, it's time for us to open the doors and go. Let's go. And that's what this album is called, and that's what this song is called. Here we go. Come on.
One step forward, two steps back. Sometimes it's a matter of fact, oh yeah. Hope's in the mile away. No matter what you do, no matter what you say, oh yeah. Then comes the question that I ask myself, what is the bat for me? Go. No time to stop. Just take your shot. It's harder when you're on your own. It's so much better when you're not alone. Oh, yeah. So I accept that when the walls close in, you can break away from the pits you've been. Oh, yeah. A three-stranded cord, not easily broken. Faith, my God and me. Go. Just take your shot. Keep moving on. Yeah, yeah. Go. No time for fear. The path is clear. They can break you down or they can make you grow. And each one tries to take a piece of your heart. If you don't give in, you don't worry apart. Yeah, yeah. All right. Come to stop.
you guys. Yes. You know, when I talked about my family, I did an album called The Grafting. And The Grafting was the album, the whole album was about family. In fact, it was the third album that I did, a solo album that I did, after about four, oh my gosh, 10 years between the first and second and the third. And at the time, I really didn't know what to write about. I knew I needed to do another solo record, but I had no idea what to write about. It was really, I was really struggling. And I was coming home from a show on an airplane, and I was just sitting by myself, and I was saying, God, come, you know, I'm really, this is not cool. And all of a sudden he goes, okay, what's important to your life? What's important to your life right now? I said, well, family. He goes, there you go. There you go. And so actually my first five grandkids were either adopted or my sons married single ladies. And I wanted to write a song about the fact, not only adoption, how wonderful it is, but to say thank you, ladies, for having the courage to have my grandsons or granddaughters. And so this song is called The Grafting. You know, it's funny. It doesn't translate in Europe. You would think that the Bible would translate, period. I mean, we're grafted into the family. We're grafted, the roots, is root is there, and the branch, the wild branches are grafted as we are the wild branches. And I would have thought there would be a word in German, Spanish, but for some reason it just goes right out the window in Europe, South America. So, well, at least we can enjoy it here in America, you know? So I hope you enjoy it.
Life is a golden opportunity
Thank you, guys. You know, I didn't realize I was gabbing quite so much. I've got one more song for you. This song is what I really do a lot of. It was actually the title cut of the last album that Petra ever did, and once that record came out and it stomped so well and nobody cared, we realized it was retirement time. I'm serious. I mean, we did a record that I think is one of the rockin'est albums Petra ever did, and we were very pleased with it. We thought for sure it was going to finally be used, and it wasn't. We realized then that our time had come and gone. So this has good memories and bad memories, but to tell you the truth, I'm so glad we did it. This is about the fact that we all are sinners and saints, or as a classic would say, Jekyll and Hydes. Come on, because I'm telling you, I realize right now, no matter how much I try to be good, I'm not. I blow it every day. That's why the blood of Christ had to be shed for us, all of us. And I made this example of, you know, if you pray, oh, Lord, I want to do good. I want to do good today. I want to do good today. And you get in the car and get behind the first slow person. What happens? That's right. We turn into the monster that we don't want to be. And this song all about the fact that we are both, but Christ loves us and has a plan for us, and the blood of Christ gave us a chance to overcome. Are we cool? Come on, let's do it. Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing the Sunday with me. Pastor, thank you for your courage to bring this wacky type of guy out. But after seeing your church, I'm not wacky. I'm actually rather tame. And I love it. God bless you guys. Thank you for being part of the family.
John, my name's Mark, but the Holy Spirit gave me a verse just concerning you whenever of where you've come from and what you're sharing. And the verse was in Matthew 13 and 52, and he says that Jesus said unto them, therefore every scribe instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out of his treasure things new and old. And so I speak to the, it's all right for me to touch you on your heart.
Please.
I speak to the treasure that is in your heart and the scribe that you have been concerning the kingdom of God, that out of your heart comes treasures that are old and new. The word says that singing to the Lord a new song. And some of the songs that you thought were old to the next generation are new. And so out of your treasure is both old and new. And some of the songs that you sang earlier, I had memories of times when I remembered that, and I remember this season. But in the next season, some of your old will be totally new seasons for another generation. And so that you can recognize a good scribe concerning the kingdom of heaven is able to take out of your treasure, and you've shared some of your treasure today and some of the experiences of your life, that you can take out of those both old and new. And the purpose is for transformation. You've demonstrated the transformation that has been in your life, and sometimes the transformation is every morning from the Jekyll to Hyde. Yeah. And so that you might release that transformation. And so I just speak into your life. Sorry if I pray over you. Let's go this way. Just that which signifies covenant. I release the goodness of God over your life again and again, where it's new every morning. I speak God's grace over you that says there's an empowering presence of God which enables you to be who you're created to be and to do what you're called to do. And so his calling is new each morning. In fact, his word says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body, as a living sacrifice. That your body be holy and acceptable unto God, which is a reasonable service. And that you're choosing not to be conformed to this world, but you're being totally transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so I just release the anointing again and again that you can allow others' minds to be renewed so that they can receive Jesus in their hearts. And so I bless you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Bless you. Bless you. Pastor Barry.
Hey, I want y'all to see something. Come over here, John. See this pocket? I want you to step in there. Can you get in there? Well, it's not a cassette tape anymore either. I saw a pastor do that once. So he can't get in my pocket, but I can take John with me and put him here. But I think you have CDs out here. I think they'll go in your back pocket. So get in that pocket, John. Listen, out here on the table, John has a merchandise table, and he has CDs out there. You want to tell them about what you have out there and the price and all that?
Yeah, I've got my newest record. I've got collections of my solo records. I think there's several Petra records. I don't know for sure because we sold a lot last night, but I know that we have Go, which is my newest record, like I said, my oldest new record, and The Grafting, which I love. I really love that song. Just a lot of, if you have questions, I'll be back there, and I can answer questions about what kind of music is, why I did the record, the whole thing. And I think I've got some pictures. I've got antique pictures out there where I actually look young. Those are going for nothing. And then I've got one that's really doctored up, makes me look good. Now that's expensive.
Let's see what the filter can do. Get a picture here. I'm like Boss Hogg. You don't come in here unless I get a picture with you. Let's hear it again for John Schlitt. We love you, brother. Love you. Everybody stand to your feet. We love you, Lord. We praise your holy name, Father God. You are worthy to be praised. We celebrate you today. We love you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. I say go in peace in Jesus' name and all God's people. Let's give a rebel, yeah. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's hear it.